before I give a talk on this subject, and so somebody asks me whether I plan to prove Riemann hypothesis. And so I should explain that everything started in non-Archimedean analytic geometry, and so I came across them in searching for appropriate framework for so-called skeletons of non-Archimedean analytic spaces and formal schemes. So in fact, I will not talk about these objects. There are certain closed subsets of non-Archimedean analytic spaces which have something like CW complexes and have a lot of additional structures. And so I'm still trying to understand what it is. Now, so these schemes and analytic spaces are some intermediate objects, in fact, which appeared. This for me. And so now I can tell what do they represent. And in algebraic geometry and also in analytic geometry, there are many objects, varieties or analytic spaces which are defined independently on the ground field. Precisely these schemes and analytic spaces over F1 represent such schemes and non-Archimedean and complex analytic spaces. And so, for example, of course, simplest examples are projective space, affine space, or torus embeddings. And so these are varieties of analytic spaces which are, whose definition is of combinatorial nature. And precisely these schemes and analytic spaces is a tool or language to talk about these objects, to deal with them. And so we do not get, of course, all possible varieties. And so, for example, the varieties we get are defined by binomial equations only, they are rational. But on the other hand, they are well adapted for describing something like if we have a lot of irreducible components or singularities of certain type. And so now the natural question, what are they good for? And so besides some motivation I have in mind, and so outside that, still I do not know. And at least I do know that they are not good for proving Riemann hypothesis. And so everybody may be relaxed. Okay, and so here is a plan. And I'll not talk about algebraic geometry, only some basic facts about, so I start from the very beginning. F1 algebras are analogs of commutative rings. And I only define these objects, very, very simple, you'll see. And I introduce the notion of a spectrum, of the spectrum of such an algebra, some list, some properties. And so after that, I stop. I will not define global object. So by the way, the definition will not is non-trivial ideologically. And so I'll switch to analytic geometry. And so in fact, in analytic geometry, everything is even more interesting, less trivial. And so I'll introduce Banach F1 algebras, K-affinoid algebras, local objects of analytic geometry, affinoid spaces. After that, analytic spaces, and then I'll explain what are non-Archimedean analytic spaces one can get from such analytic spaces over F1, and we'll see what it is. And of course, we'll find that there are, in fact, familiar objects that relate to logarithmic spaces, and also complex analytic spaces, which one can get. Okay. So we start from the very beginning. So F1 algebra is a commutative multiplicative monoid provided with elements 1 and 0 which behave like 1 and 0 in the usual sense. So the operation is multiplication. A homomorphism of two such objects is a map compatible with the operation and that takes 0 to 0 and 1 to 1. So it's natural. Only I introduce first class of such objects, two classes. First of all, A is integral if the cancellation rule holds, the very natural sense. And it is much stronger than to say that A has no zero divisors. So, and A is an F1 field if every non-zero element is invertible. So I denote in such a way the set of non-zero elements, and A star is the usual notation for the set of, for the group of invertible elements, and so they coincide. Of course, there is a natural operation of localization with respect to some sub-semigroup, and in particular, if A has no zero divisors, one can localize with respect to the all set of all non-zero elements, and one gets fraction F1 fields, field of A. Which is also very. Now, what are examples of such objects? First of all, the field of one element. Here is this object, nothing mysterious. And so it has, you see, two elements, but it has no addition. Even there is, and so the field of one element is the initial object of this category. But there is the final object. It's a trivial F1 algebra when 0 equals to 1. And so it's all. It really consists of one element. Now, first of all, the next example, if you have a usual ring, commutative ring, one can forget about addition and one gets F1 algebra. For example, F1 algebra associated with the field of two elements. Here are more examples, the set of non-negative real numbers and the set of non-negative integers. The first one is F1 field, second one is integral F1 algebra. Now construction, if we have an F1 algebra, we can form something analog of the algebra of polynomials, but in fact it consists only of monomials, non-zero elements of this F1 algebra have this form, and so, and there, this set is provided with evident multiplication, so it's an important example. And also some simple example, if what is a finite idempotent F1 algebra? First of all, idempotent means that every element, square of every element equals to itself, and finite, it's a finite set. And so if we provide this algebra with the partial ordering in such a way, then what we get is so-called lattice. And it's a partially ordered set which has supremum and infimum. Supremum here is 0, infimum is 1. And conversely, any lattice structure on a finite set gives rise to F1 algebra structure on A. Idempotent, of course, where multiplication is simply supremum of two elements. Now, what is ideal? So, it's the first thing which is not evident. So, an ideal of F1 algebra is an equivalence relation which is compatible with the operation on A. That is a subset here, which is an equivalence relation and an F1 subalgebra. And so why it is a natural object? Because if you have an ideal, we can consider the set of equivalence classes and it has the structure of F1 algebra. Of course, there is a naive notion of an ideal. I call this Zariski ideal, simply a subset in A with this the usual property of an ideal. So you see that here for F1 algebras, these two objects, as the second one is a particular case of the first one, I'll explain why, but the right object to consider to define spectrum is this notion. Now, examples of ideals. No, first of all, the first example, the diagonal. Seems a trivial, the minimal ideal. It's the minimal ideal of A, so diagonal. And so the quotient by this ideal is A itself, so it's the minimal ideal. It's an arc. Now, if we have a Zariski ideal, then we can consider the following ideal, which consists of diagonal plus all elements with coordinates from this Zariski ideal. And so we get an ideal in that sense. And so the corresponding quotient is denoted in such a way, and in fact it is simply we glue all elements of this Zariski ideal to zero and we get a new F1 algebra. What is curious, the union of any family of Zariski ideals is a Zariski ideal. it's trivial simply what. And so there is a maximal non-trivial Zariski ideal. It's a simply the set of non-invertible elements also form an ideal in its maximum. Here is a definition of a nil radical of A, and we'll see why. First of all, it looks like, and so it is a set of all pairs Fj such that there exist n with this property, that the powers of f and j are equal for all I bigger than n. And so A is reduced if the nil radical is coincides with the diagonal. Here is one more example. Simply, if we have a subgroup in A star, then we can form an ideal such that the quotient by this ideal simply is the set of orbits. It's in fact, if A is an F1 field, then each ideal of A is of this form. It's an easy exercise. But now, what is a kernel? And so if you have a homomorphism between two F1 algebras, then there is a kernel, and there is the Zariski kernel. And so the Zariski kernel is the preimage of zero, but the kernel consists of all pairs of elements whose images are equal. And so the quotient of A by kernel is isomorphic to the image. But it is not true, of course, for the Zariski kernel. Now, what is a prime ideal? And so an ideal pi is called prime if it is non-trivial and possesses the property that its quotient by this ideal is a non-trivial integral F1 algebra. It is spelled out here in elementary terms. Now, we call Zariski ideal prime if it is non-trivial and possesses the property that the quotient by this ideal is non-trivial and has no zero divisors. And so these two definitions already are not compatible in the sense we'll see now. And so the set of prime ideals and of Zariski prime ideals are denoted in such a way. F stands for F1, like spectrum of A. It's Zariski spectrum. And in fact, this spectrum of A is the right object to define schemes. Now, these annotations, if you have a point of the spectrum, it's better to define, to denote by usual letter X, then the fraction field, F1 field, of the quotient, of the corresponding quotient, is denoted kappa of X. And the image of an element of A in kappa of X is denoted by F of X, the usual way. And the same for only I need kappa of pi. If pi is a Zariski ideal, then in such a way, this F1 algebra has no zero divisor, we can consider its fraction field. And so kappa of pi. Now, there is a surjective map from the spectrum to the Zariski spectrum. Simply, if you have a point, it goes ideal, it goes to the Zariski ideal of all elements which vanish at this point. And so it is a Zariski prime ideal. And this map is surjective. And in fact, one can easily describe it's an easy exercise that there is a canonical bijection between the preimage of Zariski prime ideal and the set of all subgroups of this group, kappa of pi star. It's very easy exercise. And so everything, in fact, is very easy. There is nothing here difficult. Now, the prime ideal, for example, the prime ideal that corresponds to the unit subgroup, to the minimal subgroup of this group, is denoted in such a way. And so it's a minimal prime ideal which stands over pi, over the Zariski prime ideal. And so see that nil radical I defined earlier coincides with the intersection of all prime ideals. But in fact, it's enough to take only these ideals, which are minimal. And here is an elementary description of this set. So it consists of all pairs where either F and J are elements of this Zariski ideal, or this is true for some H outside this Zariski ideal. Okay. Now, what is the topology on the spectrum? So here, in fact, I'll stop. Now, the spectrum is provided with the topology whose base is formed by sets of this form. So now let me explain. And so first of all, if we have two elements F and J, then we consider the set DFJ is a set of all prime ideals where the values of F and J are not equal. It's something more general than principal open subset, but such sets do not form a base of topology, only subbase. And so to get base of topology, one should consider finite intersections. So it is, and so this spectrum is provided with such topology. Now, what is good with this space? Now, I only list several simple properties. So first of all, it has the same properties as a spectrum of a usual commutative ring. It's a quasi-compact sober topological space, and so sober, I always should remind that it's a topological space in which every closed reducible subset has a unique generic point. Sometimes it's called Kolmogorov space in Grothendieck probably. Now, a simple example, if I is an idempotent algebra, this means that all elements are idempotent, then the spectrum is a profinite space, projective limit of finite sets, and so it's Hausdorff theorem. Now, let IA denote the idempotent F1 subalgebra, and so the subalgebra of all idempotent elements. So simply I list properties. Of course, there is a canonical map from the spectrum of A to the spectrum of this, to this profinite space. Now, this map is surjective. Its fibers are connected. And so it induces a homeomorphism between pi zero of this space with this spectrum, with this profinite. And so pi zero is a set of all connected components. And so a connected component of a point is the maximal subspace which contains this point and which is connected. And so it is a closed subset. It's not necessarily open. But what is good due to these facts that every component coincides with the intersection of all open closed subsets which contain this point. It's also not always true. Okay, and so now I only want to say that starting from this notion, one can so introduce, first of all, affine schemes and the notion of open affine subscheme and define global object. And so here I stop. It is non-evident how to define global object, or the only thing I want to say. And so one should, one should do, I'll demonstrate on the example of the notion of analytic space, in a sense. There will be a small difference. But, and so first of all, what is a Banach F1 algebra? And so in analytic geometry, first of all, we should start with this notion. And so a Banach F1 algebra is an F1 algebra provided with a Banach norm. This real valued function taking non-negative values with these two properties. So you see, we have no triangle axiom, and we do not require anything about convergence. That's all. Only requirement that it takes zero at zero, that's all, and some multiplicative function. We'll consider examples. And so, of course, all such objects form a category with respect to bounded homomorphisms, which are defined in the natural way. By the way, I want to say that I even have more slides in my homepage. And so it's, if somebody is interested, and so one can find, because I'll skip certain things. Now, examples. So first of all, a Banach F1 algebra K is called a real valuation F1 field if it is an F1 field and its norm is multiplicative. For example, we take C, the field of complex numbers, it's F1 field, real valuation, or any non-Archimedean field. And so in this case, this set of all values, real values of all elements, is an F1 subfield of R plus. And if we denote K with two stars, the set of all elements whose norm is equal to one, then there is such an isomorphism. It's simply an example. Now, of course, if we take an arbitrary commutative Banach ring, then its multiplicative monoid can be considered as a Banach F1 algebra. Now, an important example construction for a Banach F1 algebra A and a tuple of positive numbers, one introduces the following Tate algebra. And so in fact, as an F1 algebra, it is the same set, is the same F1 algebra of monomials, so terms. But only the Banach norm depends on these elements, and the norm is defined in this way, and this Banach algebra is denoted in this way. It's like, now, if you have an ideal, that of course one can consider the quotient and define this function, you see, in the usual way, but it's not always a Banach norm. The first axiom is not true, it's not. And so it is a Banach norm if and only if E is closed. So that this function is not equal to zero at non-zero classes. So in such a way one gets closure, slightly one should increase. Okay, it's not important. Now, what is the spectrum of Banach F1 algebra? And so the spectrum is the set of all bounded homomorphisms of Banach F1 algebras. So it's the same as to say bounded multiplicative semi-norms. So here we have no addition, and so simply homomorphisms, but only they should be bounded by the Banach norm. So again, notation. And so for a point of the spectrum, we, in such a way, denote point in the usual way, x, y, semi-norm, it is a corresponding semi-norm, and it gives rise to a multiplicative semi-norm real on h of x. H of x, in fact, is a kappa of pi of f of x, where pi of x is a set of all elements where this semi-norm equals to zero. And so also it gives rise to a character from a to h of x, f goes to f of x. It's simply a convenient notation. Simply, this means that there exists a constant such that the Banach norm or norm or semi-norm of the image is at most C times the Banach norm of the original element. It's a usual the same. Now, what is a spectrum is provided with a weakest topology with respect to which all real valued functions of this form are continuous. It's in the same way as in the classical, nothing unusual. Now, and also the same fact holds, in fact, in the same proof, also is applicable here. And so if A is non-trivial, then it is a non-empty compact space. Compact, in particular, Hausdorff, of course, it's assumed that. Now we'll consider example, we'll see what it is, because for non-Archimedean spaces, you see that these objects maybe like, it's not so easy to visualize, but here it's an easy consequence. An element is invertible if and only if it doesn't vanish at any point. So one can introduce a spectral radius, it's not so in the same way, and the spectral radius is equal to the maximal value, it's the same. It's nothing new. Now I come to K-affinoid algebras. So let us take a real valuation F1 field, for example C, or any non-Archimedean field, and so we forget addition. Now, or F1, for example. Right? And so a K-affinoid algebra is a Banach K algebra for which there exists an admissible epimorphism. So first of all, epimorphism is the usual set theoretic sense. Not in the categorical sense, by the way. Once somebody asked me whether it's a sense, it's simply it's surjective homomorphism. But what is admissible means that the Banach norm on A is equivalent is to the quotient of this Tate algebra by the kernel. It's in the same definition as non-Archimedean geometry. Okay, and so it is a class of algebras, an analog of affinoid algebras. Now, simple example, if you have a real valuation field K prime with finitely generated grouping, so this means that we are given a homomorphism from K to K prime, isometric, not necessarily even injective, isometric. And so if the kernel is finitely generated, then it is a K affinoid algebra, it's very easy to. So in particular, all those fields H of X of all points are K-affinoid algebras. It's slightly different. It's different from usual situation where H of X is quite can be like it's an infinite extension of the ground field, and so it's not K-affinoid algebra. But here, it's a K-finite algebra. Now, an important example, and also it tells something about what are these objects. And in fact, everything started from here. Let R, this R, is an F1 subfield of the field of non-negative numbers. An R affinoid polytope in R plus N is a subset defined by a finite number of equalities where F and J are terms. Okay, it's and inequalities of this form. Ti is at most Ri, where Ri are positive. And so Ti are coordinate functions. So T is an element of this space. And so, in fact, what it means, if you look at it, affinoid space is a quotient of Tate algebra by an ideal. And so that it is a Tate algebra with the tuple R1, Rn, here is we have this inequalities, and simply we consider ideal generated by binomial equations. So it's a binomial equation. Monomial is equal to another monomial. It may be equal to zero, even. We'll see what it is. And so for R affinoid, by the way, let me explain you that there is nothing here. This notion simply generalize the notion of a usual polytope, classical polytope, rational polytope. And so this space contains the following subspace, subset of all tuples with non-zero coordinates. And so what it is? So if you take a branch of logarithm, we get the usual Euclidean space. And so if this R V, set V, happens to lie completely in this open subspace, it may happen, then what we get here, we get usual polytope. And every usual polytope can be viewed in such a way if we adjoin additional variables. And so usual polytope is rational coefficients, I mean that rational polytope. So it's a usual polytope is defined by inequalities. One linear function is at most another linear function. And so what is the requirement that coefficients at variable are rational numbers, but free term may be an arbitrary real number. And if we join additional variables, we can achieve only equalities. So, and so this notion is simply a generalization of the notion of the usual polytope. So
you
it's
add some bounded
infinity. What?
You add some bounded infinity.
Infinity is zero here. Yes, yes, yes. Because of that, I prefer this, yes. Now, for an R affinoid polytope, consider the set of all, and so the restrictions of all monomials to this set. And so the set of all continuous functions, which are restrictions of function coming from here. And so it's a Banach R algebra with respect to the supremum norm. And R polytopal algebra is a Banach R algebra isomorphic to the algebra of this form for some R affinoid polytope. Okay, it's now a fact that any R polytopal algebra is R affinoid algebra. And so it's simply an example. It's not so evident, it's not difficult, but it's an example of affinoid algebras, and so there are plenty. Even in such a way, one can start from a usual polytope, classical polytope, and one gets, in fact, a field, F1 field, but which is a Banach field. Okay, what is now the spectrum of an arbitrary K affinoid algebra? And so let A be a K affinoid algebra, and we fix an epimorphism as in the definition of this object, and so then the spectrum of A is identified with a compact subset here. The fact that it is an affinoid polytope, even precisely if you consider all this. See, absolute value of K. Some additional properties. The Zariski spectrum of such algebra is finite. The map from X to the Zariski spectrum is surjective. In fact, it has a very geometric meaning, the risky spectrum simply. Fortunately, I have no time. And there is an isomorphism of partially ordered set. In fact, it's something which I formulated at the very end of algebraic geometry part. And so in this case, the set of connected components is always finite, and even it is a partially ordered set, one can provide it. And so also, it is a set of all non-zero idempotent in this algebra. And so they are canonically isomorphic as a partially ordered set. In any case, it's something, it's not important, simply it's a curious. Okay, and so now I want to say that such affinoid algebras possess all natural properties of ABAK affinoid algebra. So what are usual properties which are very important and which allows one to develop the whole theory of non-Archimedean analytic geometry? And so the first property that for every non-nilpotent element F, there exists C, positive C, such that the Banach norm of F to the power N is at most C to the nth power of the spectral norm of F. In fact, it's a very important property. It was discovered by Tate. And so only this property allows one to do everything, in fact, usually. In fact, if A is reduced, then the spectral norm and Banach norm are equivalent. Also, it's very curious. Now, why it is important, this property, or the first property? Because if we have a bounded homomorphism of K affinoid algebras from A to B, so if we are given an elements of B and a tuple of positive numbers, but with this inequality that R I's are at least spectral norms of F I's, then one can extend this bounded homomorphism to a unique bounded homomorphism from this algebra to B that sends Ti to Fi. And in fact, if you analyze this, it's not evident. And so here is a property which really one needs. And so it's the same as in analytic geometry. It's very important. Okay, there are other properties. There are many other properties. Simply, I stop here. Now we consider affinoid spaces, because the real differences start here. And so the category of K affinoid spaces is by definition the category opposite to the category of K affinoid algebras. It's by definition. And so of course we mention an affinoid space by its spectrum, but we always know that there is an underlying K affinoid algebra, and the morphisms come from bounded homomorphisms of K affinoid algebras. Now, definition, a closed subset is called an affinoid domain if there is a homomorphism. It's the same definition as in non-Archimedean geometry. If there is a homomorphism of K affinoid algebras from A to AB such that the image of the spectrum of AV lies in V, and this property is universal. And so this homomorphism is universal. This means that if you have a similar homomorphism from A to B, but of K affinoid algebras, such that the image of the spectrum of B in X lies in V, then it goes through the unique homomorphism from AV to B. It's a usual, we'll consider examples. But by the way, in a similar way, one defines the notion of an open affine subscheme. The only difference that in the previous story, in the previous algebraic geometry, and so we start from an open subset, and so we require that we start from open subset, and it possesses the same property. So then we get the usual notion of an open affine subscheme, and also in classical algebraic geometry. Okay, very simple facts which follow from the definition that if you have such an affinoid domain, then this map is always a bijection. And also the fields of points do not change. And so if y is an image of x, then these fields are the same. It's very. But the maps between Zariski spectra of AV to Zariski spectrum of A is injective. It's simply OK. Here are examples. So in analytic geometry, there are very important examples of affinoid domains, rational domains, and Weierstrass domains. And here are their definitions. And so probably it's not so important to look through. There is some difference in the definition. And so Weierstrass domains define in the same way completely. But rational domains, we have no addition. And so they are defined slightly different. But what is important that the fact that they are affinoid domains follow from the fact about I started with about Banach norm of f to the power n, this inequality. It is very important. Usually it is overlooked. It's so okay. And so these are important examples. And in fact, every point of x has a fundamental system of neighborhoods consistent on rational domains. Now, there are many properties. And so, but what is important, and so here I do not give this description. I have no time. But one can, in comparison with non-Archimedean geometry, one can give a complete description of affinoid domains in certain terms, which is not the case in the usual non-Archimedean geometry. And here are some consequences of this description. I only mention one. And so if U is an affinoid domain is connected, then it is rational. Let me only note, there are many properties, a lot of nice properties, but every connected affinoid domain is a rational domain. It is not true in non-Archimedean geometry. So there are some other properties. Let me skip. It's not important, and I have no time. OK, now we come to something which is really unusual. So assume that we have. Now we should, in Archimedean geometry, there is so-called theta cyclicity theorem. And so if you have a finite affinoid covering of a k-affinoid space, so let us consider this kernel. And so usual theta cyclicity theorem tells that it is the same as the algebra A. This is not true here. And so what is true? And so we provide this kernel with the supremum norm. Only one can claim that it is an admissible monomorphism. Monomorphism is an injective map. And admissible means that the Banach norm on A is equivalent to the norm induced from this algebra. Now, X is said to be acyclic if the above map is bijection for any finite affinoid covering. So it is not true that, so we should do something with that. Theta cyclicity theorem is not true, but what is true is that every point X has an affinoid neighborhood such that U, such that every affinoid domain V, which contains this point and is contained in U, is acyclic. So the whole space may not be acyclic. The easiest example, if X is not connected, it is not acyclic. We have no addition, and so. But in fact, even connected affinoid space may be not acyclic. But nevertheless, this fact is true. And it follows from this fact that if we are given two finite affinoid coverings, U and V, such that V is a refinement of U, then the canonical map is an admissible monomorphism. And in fact, there exists such finite affinoid coverings that for any refinement, we do not get anything new. And so this homomorphism is a bijection. Now, the full subcategory of the category of k-affinoid spaces consisting of acyclic, I need this category to define global object. And so it is denoted in such a way. Now, I also need the category with the same family of objects, but affinoid domain embeddings as morphisms. And so in such a way, and so it is the category of acyclic affinoid spaces with affinoid domain embeddings as morphisms. What I'm doing now is the same as in non-Archimedean geometry in the definition. So what is a K-analytic space? And so I, first of all, definition. So first definition, a family of subsets of a topological space is called quasinet if for every x there exists v1, vn, such that x lies in the intersection of them, and their union is a neighborhood of x. Neighborhood, this means contains an open neighborhood. And so, if, for example, if these sets are open, then it simply means that it is an open covering, nothing more. But in our case, they are compact, in fact, we'll see. Now, quasi-net is called net if for every pair u and v in this family, the restriction of this quasi-net to the intersection is a quasi-net on the intersection. Restriction means that we consider all sets from this family which lie in the intersection, that this should be quasi-net. And so, again, if this family consists of open sets, then this net, to be a net means that this family is a basis of some topology. In any case, it's a definition. We have compact sets. Now, and so we consider tau as a category. Now, I have to define global object, analytic space. So we consider such a family as a category in by big T, I denote the canonical functor from this category to the category of topological space. Meanwhile, it's in topological space. Now we'll come to definition, but simply if you have such a topological space and a net, I denote by T the canonical functor from this category tau to the category of topological spaces, something tautological. But what now, in a similar way, tau with superscript A, I denote the functor from the category of acyclic affinoid spaces with affinoid domain embeddings to the category of topological space, the forgetful functor, which takes such a affinoid space to the underlying topological space. So simply, these are convenient notations. Definition. First of all, I define objects of the category. A K-analytic space is a triple where X is a locally Hausdorff topological space, tau is a net of compact subsets. Compact means that in the induced topology they are compact. And A is an acyclic affinoid atlas with a net tau, that is a functor which from tau, from this net to the category of acyclic affinoid spaces and affinoid domain embeddings as morphisms. And so instead of writing several very natural conditions, so it's a brief way to say that we are also given an isomorphism of functors. So this means that first of all, with every set from tau, we associate an affinoid space, but the underlying topological space of this affinoid space and this set should be canonically homeomorphic. So should be, we should be given a canonical homeomorphism between them, and all maps should be compatible between themselves. And so it is a brief way to say that there is such compatibility. And so if you have two sets, one lies in another, and so everything should be compatible, it's a way to say that they're compatible. Okay, it's a K-analytic space. One should define morphisms. And so it is done in the same way as in non-Archimedean geometry. And so first of all, defines a smaller class of morphisms, strong morphisms. And after that, one inverts some class of morphisms, which are called quasi-isomorphisms. So strong morphism is between such K-analytic spaces. First of all, is a continuous mapping with additional property that charts, in fact, elements of this quasi-net, it's natural to call charts. For every U, its image lies in some U prime from the net tau prime. And second, that we are given a compatible system of morphisms of K-affinoid spaces. If we have such a pair, we are given a morphism of K-affinoid spaces. but such that the maps between underlying topological spaces are the same. It's the same which are given by this continuous map. So it's a strong morphism. They define a category. One can compose such morphisms. But now strong morphisms is called a quasi-isomorphism. Now, I want to invert certain class of morphisms. And so strong morphism is a quasi-isomorphism, first of all, if it is a homeomorphism between the underlying topological spaces. And second, that for every such pair, U and U prime, such that the image of U lies in U prime, this morphism is simply affinoid domain embedding. So simply, I want to invert such. And so the category of analytic spaces is a category of fractions with respect to the system of quasi-isomorphism. So it's a natural, and again, one can describe, here is an example. And so if we start from a K affinoid space, first of all, let us take the family of all acyclic affinoid domains. It's a net. And there is an acyclic affinoid atlas with this net, it's an evident one. And in such a way, one gets a functor from the category of K affinoid spaces to the category of analytic spaces. And by the way, this functor is not fully faithful. Precisely, it's only fully faithful on the subcategory of acyclic affinoid spaces, but it's not fully faithful. So it's something which is new in comparison with usual things. By the way, the same takes place in algebraic geometry. And so the functor from affine schemes to all schemes is not fully faithful. Only it is fully faithful on connected schemes.
This category of fraction, is it also a subcategory where this kind of atlas would be maximal?
Ah, there is also maximal atlas. Yes, 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 of course. And so now, in fact, there is a, and so on, what I've said. Yes, there is a notion of an analytic domain. For this, first of all, one enlarges this set tau, net tau, with all affinoid subdomains of all such V, and so and we get a bigger net tau bar. Probably it's only important to if somebody is familiar with non-Archimedean geometries, what I'm doing. And so if you have an acyclic affinoid domain in some U from tau, then it is acyclic affinoid domain in any V that contains W. And so in such a way, we get, let us consider tau bar the set of all such W's. And it is also a net, and we can extend atlas. And so in fact, we get a new analytic space, but they are isomorphic. There is a quasi-isomorphism. Now, a subset is an analytic domain if the restriction of this tau bar to Y is a quasi-net. So it's like locally consists of such affinoid domains. Okay, and so such a subset can be provided with the structure of analytic space if we simply restrict everything. So there is a notion. Okay, it's not important here. And so all analytic domains form a Grothendieck topology, where the set of coverings of an analytic domain is formed by families of analytic domains which are quasi-nets. So it's Grothendieck it's a pre-topology, and it gives rise to a Grothendieck topology. And so it's a good topology because every representable pre-sheaf is a sheaf. And in such a way, one can construct a structural sheaf. So maybe simply, it's enough, the structural sheaf on this topology. And so it is a topology which is appropriate for the notion of structural sheaf, and also for the notion of coherent sheaf, also there is such a notion. Okay, and so for example, if V is an acyclic affinoid domain, then the sections, the F1 algebra of sections on V is AV, the algebra itself. But if V is compact analytic domain, that it's a Banach K algebra. And for any covering, finite covering, it's this map is an admissible monomorphism. Okay, it's now I have some time, and so now I want to come to something already. to connection of this with the real world, in a sense, real. Okay, and so let K small be a non-Archimedean field, and suppose we are given an isometric homomorphism of F1 fields from K big, which is an F1, real valuation F1 field, to this F1 algebra of a non-Archimedean field. So I want to associate with any analytic space over K big, some non-Archimedean analytic space. But how do I do that? So first of all, I introduce the notion of a morphism from a K analytic space Y, and so it's a non-Archimedean, from a non-Archimedean space, I say, non-Archimedean space Y, to a K analytic space X. And so morphism is a pair. It's something reminds us the definition of morphism between analytic space, non-Archimedean spaces. So it's a continuous map from Y to X, but with the additional property that you see that for every point of Y, there exist affinoid domains in Y whose intersection contains Y and whose union is a neighborhood of Y. But what is the requirement? That the image of VI lies in an acyclic affinoid subdomain of X for every I.
It's a
identity, and so we start from any non-Archimedean field. A big K is the field itself. It's the easiest example, and it makes sense. Now, the system of compatible bounded phi homomorphisms. And so if you have a pair of affinoid domains V in Y and U in X, such that the image of V lies in U, then we are given a bounded homomorphism. This dot stands for that we forget about. It's a usual non-Archimedean affinoid algebra. And so it's a bounded homomorphism. So, but what is the requirement? That the map from V to U is the same as the map induced by this homomorphism. So all this, it's the same as the notion of morphism between non-Archimedean analytic spaces. And so also here. Now, let us fix X. So it's an analytic space over F1 over K, in fact, big K. And consider the functor from the category of K small analytic spaces to the category of sets that takes a K analytic space to the set of phi morphisms from Y to X. So X is fixed. And so this functor is representable by a non-Archimedean analytic space, which is denoted in such a way, and a morphism in the previous sense between them, but compact I call, probably it's not so good, it's proper in the usual topological sense. It's a compact map. It's a compact map, it's a proper map. Simply in non-Archimedean geometry, the notion of a proper morphism, a proper map are not equivalent, and so I called such proper maps between topological spaces compact map. Probably it's not good, but it's a compact map, proper map. Now, phi induces a morphism of sides because there are Grothendieck topology on both spaces, and it induces a homomorphism of sheaves. So you see, it's a direct image of this sheaf. And this functor, of course, behaves well with respect to all possible operations. Of course, here we have a notion of proper morphism, which is not so evident, but nevertheless, they behave well. Now, it is not surprising, all this. What it is, the easiest case, if we have X is K affinoid space. And so what is the X phi? It's something I denote in such way. It's like a semigroup algebra, and so we can if we decode the definition of morphism only for affinoid spaces, and so we find that simply one can associate with any K-affinoid algebra, one can associate so-called, it's something like semigroup algebra of A. And it is an affinoid algebra in the non-Archimedean sense. It's very natural. And so it's simply, if A is a quotient of Tate algebra in this sense by ideals that here it is a quotient of a similar Tate algebra by the same ideal, generators, by the same generators. So there is nothing unusual. Now, here simply I introduce several classes of analytic spaces, some very natural restrictions. I have no time, it's not so important. Some restrictions and so that what we get is non-trivial, for example, for trivial reason it may be, but it's not so important. So here I introduce some restrictive classes of analytic spaces. Okay, but what are properties of this map? Simply, if E is non-trivial, then the map pi from this non-Archimedean space to X is surjective and takes analytic domains, non-Archimedean space, to analytic domains in X. If X is really some super, meanwhile I call super special, but then there is a section, canonical continuous section from analytic space over F1 to non-Archimedean space of that map, surjective map pi. And moreover, there is a strong deformation retraction of the non-Archimedean analytic space to the image of this section. So in fact, this reminds, it's a simply a particular case of a skeleton of non-Archimedean analytic space, which I considered previously, but not all possible examples. Now, the full subcategory, now I want to describe the image of this one. What is the image? What are the analytic spaces we get in such a way? And so first of all, let us denote the full subcategory consisting of phi special. So it means that some restrictions in such a way. And after that, okay, after that, it's a definition of so-called, if you have a non-Archimedean space, it's a definition of a sheaf of Banach K algebras. It is something should remind the notion of logarithmic space, and so is a sheaf of monoids, but on this space, but it should be provided with a Banach structure. It's an additional extra structure. They are not abstract monoids or F1 algebras. Here they are F1, but what is the requirement that the sections of the sheaf on the family of compact analytic domains, so are Banach K algebras with additional properties. Okay. So here I introduce very natural notions. And so here is an example. If you have a non-Archimedean analytic space, then the structural sheaf on it is a sheaf of such Banach algebras, if you forget addition. And so what is important if for a K-analytic space, now you remember that pi induces morphism of sides, let us consider the preimage, the inverse image of the structural sheaf of X to the non-Archimedean analytic space. And it is a sheaf of Banach K algebras. And this homomorphism is bounded. And so you see, it is a structural sheaf on a non-Archimedean analytic space, is a sheaf of F1 algebras, like something like monoids of certain type we consider usually in logarithmic geometry, and it is a homomorphism. Now, here I introduce the notion of K-analytic space with prelogarithmic structure. By the way, everything else also takes place in algebraic geometry, and so. But there we do not have the notion of we do not have Banach spaces, so everything is much easier. But K-analytic space with a prelogarithmic structure is a triple, is a non-Archimedean space Y, a sheaf of Banach K algebras, and so this F1 algebras on this Grothendieck topology, and a bounded homomorphism of sheaves of Banach algebra from this sheaf of monoids to the structural sheaf. And so it should be bounded. And so morphism between two such triples is defined in the natural way, it's simply, and in such a way I denote the category of such objects, of such triples. And so it's something reminds us the notion of logarithmic space and the description. And so if we start from a analytic space. You remember, special, it's in such a way I denoted phi special analytic spaces over F1 over K big. And if you associate with it this triple, the non-Archimedean space, the preimage of this, of its structural sheaf, which is the sheaf of Banach algebras. And alpha is a homomorphism from here to the structural sheaf of this non-Archimedean space. And so we get a functor, but what is the point? That this functor is fully faithful. So in fact, one can describe in the usual terms, the objects I define over F1. And so moreover, one can describe the essential image of this functor. And so here, some very natural description of this image. And so they are, why it is called pre-logarithmic structure, because in the notion of logarithmic structure, one requires that such pre-logarithmic structure possesses an additional property. And so if you consider the preimage of invertible functions, then the map on this preimage to the subsheaf of invertible function is a bijection. And so simply here, it is not the case because of that is a pre-logarithmic. And so now I only want to say that what is something slightly new. And so if one really needs to consider logarithmic spaces for non-Archimedean spaces, one should not forget about Banach structure. What is new is that one should not only consider sheaf of monoids, there is an extra structure one should regard. And similar takes place for complex analytic spaces. Here, simply, I have no time. I only, like, from sky will see. And so in complex analytic geometry, we have no such things like affinoid algebras, close polydisk is not in a complex analytic space. And so, but in the category of analytic spaces, there is a notion of spaces with boundary. There is a notion of boundary. And so one should start from analytic space without boundary. And only one can associate complex analytic spaces to a space without boundary. For example, one can associate to an open polydisk, but not to a closed polydisk. And but also, instead of Banach norms, which are considered before, one should consider extend this notion. One should consider more general object Fréchet algebras. And in a similar way, one introduces a notion, and so Fréchet algebras, and the notion of Stein spaces in that category. And so, and after that, all possible, if you have such a homomorphism of fields, isometric, one can introduce the notion of morphism from a complex analytic space to a kinematic space, but without boundary. So I didn't define, but there is such a notion, like in non-Archimedean geometry. And so it's a continuous mapping without any additional requirement, because there is no boundary here. And also system of compatible bounded phi homomorphisms for all pairs consisting of open Stein subspaces. Instead of affinoid domains, we consider open Stein subspaces, but their global sections are not Banach algebras, are Fréchet algebras, and there is a notion of bounded. And also one introduces a similar functor, and one shows that this functor is representable by a complex analytic space, and also and compact morphism. So even as I said, there is a description. And so for any open Stein subspace, the preimage is an open Stein subspace here. And if X is separated, that the preimage of affinoid domain is so-called Stein compact. Also, there is such a notion in complex analytic geometry. This functor possesses all natural properties. By the way, what is the relation of between these analytic spaces? And it's if, again, X is non-trivial in a sense, certain sense, then it is an open surjective map, surjective and open, and its fibers are direct products of real tori of a real torus and a finite set. And if it is so-called phi special, more restrictive, then fibers are tori, real tori. And even if, for example, it is an additionally reducible, then there is an action of real torus on a complex analytic space such that the quotient by this this action is simply this analytic space over F1. It's instead of those number sections and so on. And in a similar way, one can, first of all, one introduces a category of analytic spaces without boundary, and one can describe the image of that functor. And again, one needs some terminology, and but then the answer is similar. And so complex analytic space, one with a pre-logarithmic structure, one introduces a complex analytic space, a sheaf of Frischer algebras. It's also one should consider also some, not only sheaf of abstract monoids, but also monoids provided with some extra structure and bounded homomorphism. And one introduces a category. And so also similar statements hold here. There is a fully faithful functor. And so that functor we constructed is fully faithful from the category of K analytic spaces without boundary to the category of this complex analytic spaces with this pre-logarithmic structure. Okay, and one can describe the image. Of course, we do not get everything in this way. And that's all. I'm sorry, I took slightly more time. Thank you.